Every picture tells a story, and every color has a meaning, sometimes hidden. Here on my stole, we have the colors associated with the pride rainbow. But I would point out in particular the orange at the bottom of the stole, which is associated also with the gun violence which has permeated our society. And so to remember the victims of gun violence and to those who take a stand against gun violence, I and others are wearing orange this weekend. For opening words to center us, I turn to this meditation by my colleague Leslie Takashi. Here in this place of peace, may we find hope. Here in this place of connection, may we find both communion and community. Here in this place of rest, let the unrest of our hearts turn us towards justice. Here in this space made sacred by memories of connection, let each of us feel ourselves to be part of the new that grows from the old in the spiraling unity of the years and the generations. A flower communion is an extraordinary event. The fact that we use the word communion to bring things and to tie people together, to lift up connections that feed us, is an extraordinary ritual, something that even the most liberal individual needs to hear from time to time. Now, to illustrate some concepts that I hope to bear out in my homily today, I invite Andy, can I impose upon you? This is my assistant, we have not practiced this. I hold in my hand two packets, which I purchased just this morning. Would you identify the contents, please?
This one is marigold, and this one is morning glory.
Morning glory and marigold. And tell me, which of these sets of flowers do you prefer?
I like this one.
We've gone with morning glory. I hear something. I'll tear it open. And I remove. We'll start with one seed. Can you verify that that is a seed?
That's a seed.
Now, mind you, I grew up in Chicago. But I know that a seed requires certain things so that we can move from this to transition to something like this. One of the ingredients would be water. Would you dip your finger in there? And please give it some water. I've heard that it also requires some light. Any time now. Am I forgetting something?
Maybe. Probably.
Perhaps what we're forgetting in this, for instance, is the element of time. Time and nurture that can transform a simple seed into something magnificent, something that looks and flourishes like a morning glory. Thank you. You may have these.
Okay.
Please be seated. Each individual who comes to this place or houses of worship like this is very much like a seed. We are at different places in our lives. Some people feel that they've been buried, that they're buried under debt, buried under depression, buried under grief. And the world seems very cold. Other people have begun to sprout roots, and they crave a deeper connection. Others, perhaps, are showing glimpses of color. that catch the attention of other people so that they can stand proud in community. But for each an individual, they depend upon what we call in this business gardeners of the spirit, which is each and every one of us together, to offer a place of silence, to offer encouragement, to offer compassion, to encourage and to challenge each other so that we can continue to grow into the best and fullest expression of ourselves. And we know that it takes time. And if we're honest about gardening, we know that sometimes we have to get down into the dirt. And it is sometimes a very difficult enterprise. It just doesn't happen. Seeds do not magically produce shoots and petals instantly. It requires care and cultivation. You say that you come here because you want beloved community. You say that you want a deeper connection to each other, or perhaps to the higher mysteries of this universe. Perhaps you are seeking justice. I suggest that each one of these aspirations is in itself a seed that we bring and dedicate to the altar of humanity. And if we are all honest gardeners of the spirit, we recognize that a solitary seed requires enormous cultivation, and we're better off when we can rely upon our neighbors to assist us. Some with certain skill sets, some with more time, some who can dedicate a portion of their lives to bring other seeds to fruition. Sometimes, it said, when you're feeling that you're in a dark place, you're not actually buried, but you've been planted. The hard shells of our lives are waiting to break away. Something is stirring within, something inherent and something restless. But how shall it grow and where shall it be planted? These flowers which we hold, and if you do not have one, please raise your hand and we'll get one to you. These flowers are an expression of nature. But as you can see, they've been cut. The Dalai Lama said, if you love a garden, do not cut it down, but let it grow. But in our lives, we know that we use flowers to mark various occasions of our lives. At the memorial service yesterday, there were many flowers to honor the life of a woman who loved the garden. For those who have had children attend various dances and proms, you know that flowers are also given to be worn as a token of affection and to add splendor to a person's outer wear. In weddings, bouquets are often carried. And in fact, during the reception, one is thrown into the crowd as a symbol, ancient, of passing on good luck. But here in this large container of a room, and here on this table with smaller containers, we are reminded that every flower that is cut, every seed that is brought to fruition, demands on a space to be held. There are those who will say that the liberal tradition has an emptiness at its center because we do not insist upon language such as God. But there are others, well versed in this tradition, who understand that the emptiness within each seed, each person, each institution calls to be filled by the gifts of people near and far, that we inspire each other, and each gift, each small blessing is carried forth and is added to a various container. Some containers might be the realm of social justice. Some might be stewardship. Some might be fellowship. Some might be religious education. Some might be building connections with other groups that are like-minded but practice different rituals and see beauty in different rituals and words. All these are precious gifts. And on this day, with this flower communion, I ask that the flower that you hold in your hand, ponder it for a moment, feel it. It's tangible, but it's also beauty. Each one is unique. There is no flower exactly the same, just as no two snowflakes are ever quite the same. The molecules present in each flower, in each leaf, and in the water that has sustained them is as ancient as the universe, but it has combined over eons and through intentionality into that expression that you hold in your hands. And it will continue long after we are gone. Those atoms will continue to fill spaces and to bring forth all kinds of creative designs that other people will hold in their hands and consider in their due time. Consider the gifts that you have given to other people in this space. Have you encouraged another? Have you assisted another? Think of all the activities that have filled this last year, from fantasy auctions to work days, to worship, to volunteering as a teacher or in that kitchen. Each moment that you stepped up is in fact a valuable and beautiful gift. And this community would not exist except for the myriad gifts that each and every one, including people not present today, have freely offered. People willing to get into the proverbial dirt and thereby exalt the spirit of this congregation. Once you have identified at least one gift that you have presented, I invite you to come forward and to choose one of these containers. Some call them vases, other vases. They're all unique, but each one is designed to hold the beauty of a flower. And together we will form an extensive bouquet representing all those gifts from all those individuals. Afterwards, during the postlude, I will invite you to please come forward and to receive one of these gifts and to take it with you in recognition of something that others have done for you. And so others, I invite you to please come forward at this time and please add a flower to one of the vases here. It's an impressive bouquet, and it keeps growing. This would be my 16th flower communion with you. I've done two additional in Park Forest, and I've attended others. And this is a relatively new tradition ritual within Unitarian Universalism. But it's extraordinary because it celebrates individuals with community, within community, aching and yearning for beloved community in all the different expressions throughout the larger community, striving for justice, striving for fellowship, striving to build connections. And there's always room for more. And so, in the spirit of Norbert Chopik, who is often credited incorrectly with inventing this particular ritual, we remember that there are other people outside these walls, aching for a message of hope, aching for deeds instead of creeds and words, desperately hoping that the beauty and the warmth experienced within community here will be extended to enrich their lives as well. Amen and blessed be. For our closing words, a combination of readings. The first is by Cynthia Ocelli, who wrote, "For seed to achieve its greatest expression, it must come completely undone. The shell cracks, it inside spill out, and everything changes. To someone who doesn't understand growth, it would look like complete destruction." And from Nancy Wood, "Hold on to what is good, even if it is a handful of dirt. Hold on to what you believe, even if it is a tree which stands by itself. Hold on to what you must do, even if it is a long way from here. Hold on to each other's hand, even when we have left this space, so that we will know and cherish each other. Amen and blessed be."